frequently as possible. So we will choose a monotherapy, the one drug we should choose, and that should be at the lowest concentration. And drugs with the lowest potential side effects should be used. And initial treatment is usually with one drug. And when therapy is ineffective, substitute rather than add the drug. So when, suppose you have started with one drug, then you, if the patient IOP is not controlled, or if you have seen IOP is controlled, but if you have seen the other clinical changes, then you thought of changing, adding the drug. So first, at the initial period, you should first add the two another drug, and rather than putting the two drugs at a time. So monitor potential ocular and systemic side effect at the same time. So what are the problems we come across after putting the drugs also? Why? There are lots of problems. So glaucoma patient has the high risk for developing ocular surface disease. So these patients, they might not use the drug regularly, either unknowingly or due to so many problems. So they will have a ocular surface disease, and both glaucoma and ocular surface disease incidence increases with the age. So this is one of the factor. And other is the large portions of the glaucoma patients are treated with preservative containing pressure lowering eye drops. So all these anti-glaucoma medications have the preservatives, and the treatment is usually prolonged for years since glaucoma is a chronic disease. So usually prolonged for a year since a glaucoma is chronic disease. So anti-glaucoma drugs and preservatives, there is a increasing evidence. So increasing evidence to demonstrate the size of portions of the local side effect may result from the preservatives rather than the active compounds. So these things are all due to the preservatives. So most commonly used preservatives is anti-glaucoma medication is benzalkonium chloride. So benzalkonium chloride is the why it is so much problem is that this preservatives is a quaternary ammonia. So the quaternary ammonia, they are with the surface, they are always act with the surface. So they cause lots of the toxic irritative reaction. So they cause the problem. So such reaction appears mainly like an irritant effect for the alcohol, whereas the other organomercurial appears to fully interact with the immune system as a new antigen. In compared to other non-quaternary ammonia, preservative seems to cause the oxidative stress to the significantly lesser extent and to induce lower cell death than the this other benzalkonium chloride. So this has got more this irritating toxic effect. So coming to the classifications about the drugs, the myotics, which is not mostly used nowadays, it was used most in the previous days. So number one is the cholinergic agent. Cholinergic agent comprises of the acetylcholine chloride, pilocarpine hydrochloride, and carbachol. So among the cholinergic agent, we use the pilocarpine still, hydrochloride, and it is available as a topical medication. And anticholinesterase agent is pediostigmine and ethiopate. So we don't use nowadays this. Alpha adrenergic agonist is alpha clonidine and dapirazole and clonidine. Sympathomimetic drugs are diazepam, epinephrine, and epinephrine borate. And adrenergic blocking agent is beta blocker. Among the beta blocker, betaxolol hydrochloride, libavinolol hydrochloride, timolol maleate, and metipronol hydrochloride. So these are very important drugs which we use frequently. And carbonic anhydrase inhibitors is also used frequently, acetazolamide, methazolamide, dorzolamide, and brinzolamide. Prostaglandin analogs, latanoprost, travoprost, and vimatoprost. So these are the drugs which are nowadays which we come and it has got the more IOP loading agent and it is more useful in a young patient. So these drugs are also frequently used nowadays. Hyperosmotic agent like glycerin, isosorbide, ethyl alcohol. These are oral and IV is managed. And urea. So these are also used if the IOP is very high for lowering them. Calcium channel blocker, anti-metabolites we use in a secondary, mostly in the secondary glaucoma, treatment of the secondary glaucoma or in case of the congenital glaucoma. And other recent like inoprostone, which is a prostaglandin analogs, neuroprotective drugs and neuroregenerative drugs like remunitine, which has used. And recent a number of the newer drugs have come into the therapeutic use in glaucoma and have already received the FDA approval. So these two drugs like dorzolamide, which is a carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, and a latanoprost, which is a prodrug for the prostaglandin F2. These two such drugs, which holds, they have a much lower side effect and they are very effective anti-glaucoma drugs which have come forward. So it is available in different percentages, which in a practically we have to know how much is it is available. And timolol maleate, it is available in 0.5%, betaxolol 0.5%, libavinolol 0.5%, pilocarpine is available in 2%, brimonidine, which is available in 0.15%, and it is also available in 0.2%. Latanoprost, it is available in 0.005%, and brimatoprost, it is available in 0.3%. So pilocarpine, which is the most common and widely used drugs of the myotics groups, and it is a direct acting parasympathetic cholinergic drugs. So this is very important for you for an exam, because always when a pilocarpine vial will be there, it is quite thin and black color written. So in the someday I will take a practical oriented class also, and I will show all the slides and the pictures of the vial and how you will present. So there you will be asked, what is the vial? So you will take, it's already written there, this is a pilocarpine, 2%, ophthalmic solution, and which group of drug they will ask. The question goes there. So there only you will be stuck in the exam, and further there all the basic questions will be asked from there. So it is a parasympathetic cholinergic drugs, and it is a first drug of choice either alone or in combinations or with other anti-glaucoma drugs. So why it's a cholinergic drugs? Because pilocarpine, it is a cholinergic drugs because any of the various drugs that inhibit, enhance or mimic the actions of neurotransmitter acetylcholine. So that is why it comes in this group. It is a primary neurotransmitter of the nerve impulses within the parasympathetic nervous system. So that's that is a part of the autonomic nervous system, which contract the smooth muscles, dilate the blood vessels, and increases the outflow. So it acts both in the open angle glaucoma as well as in the angle closure glaucoma. So in case of open angle glaucoma, or it causes a ciliary muscle contraction. So there will be the pull in the scleral spur, which increases the facilitates the aqueous outflow by altering the configurations of the trabecular meshwork and Schlemm's canal. So as it pulls the scleral spur, it will opens the Schlemm's canal. So that is how it facilitated the aqueous outflow. Similarly, in the angle closure glaucoma, if the IOP is very high, this drug is not, pilocarpine is not given. Previously, in the past days, in the more than 10 years back, it was a drug of choice, like intensive pilocarpine therapy used to give. But nowadays, we don't give in the very high IOP because they don't act in the very high IOP in the splinter pupillae, as they will be paralyzed because of the high IOP. So when the IOP is little bit to the normal or near normal level, then we will start these drugs. So it directly stimulates the splinter muscles of the iris, which improves the outflow facilities in the eye with the angle closure glaucoma. So pilocarpine is used both in open angle glaucoma and angle closure glaucoma. But the mechanism of actions in this is a little bit different. So by relieving the pupillary block or by pulling the peripheral iris from the angles, anterior chamber angle structure, so it will increase the outflow. So this is the scleral spur, and here you will be in the contractions of this pulling of this scleral spur will lead to the increase of this Schlemm's canal, resulting in a aqueous outflow. So it is used in chronic open angle glaucoma, acute angle closure glaucoma, chronic synechial angle closure glaucoma, and following the cyclodialysis surgery. Contraindication, it is not used in inflammatory glaucoma, malignant glaucoma, hypersensitivity to the drugs, and active intraocular inflammation. So pilocarpine is not used in case of the uveitis with secondary glaucoma, inflammatory glaucoma, or in the active intraocular inflammation is this. So, and its doses and solution form, its abavin solution form, and also in gel form, but over here we get in solution form, and it is available as a 2% drug solution vial. So what are the adverse reactions of the pilocarpine? It is a very important frequently used drug, and pilocarpine is also used before the peripheral iridectomy in case of acute angle closure glaucoma before doing the YAC PI. So we use this drug to constrict the pupil, and also during this period the patient can complain of the frontal headache due to the spasm. So this is a most frequently complaint of the pilocarpine, and other side effects are after the prolonged use. So there will be a constricted pupillae. So as the pupil is small, there will be problem in the visual acuity. There will be problem in the impairment of the night visions as it affects the accommodation. And the people who have got the polar cataract, they cannot see with the pilocarpine is used, frontal headache, and retinal detachment is mainly due to the more pulling or constrictions in the subsequent period, and it can cause a cataract formation, like posterior subcapsular cataract also can form due to the long-term use. It can form an iris cyst. It can also cause a mild iritis and watering and follicular conjunctivitis. And systemic toxicity is bradycardia, increased sweating, diarrhea, excessive salivation, anxiety, abdominal cramp, headache, nausea, and tremor. And some examiner like to ask you the systemic indication also and systemic toxicity about these few drugs. Alpha adrenergic agonist, which is brimonidine tartrate, or which is available as the alphagon or alphagon P. This is a second generation alpha adrenergic receptor agonist. So they acts on alpha 2 receptors and they decreases the aqueous production. So they will not let the form of the aqueous production is decreased, and most useful is it increases the EVS flare output. So it acts on both the mechanism, both the pathway. So it is an important drug, and also it is said that it is a neuroprotective drug. So it is frequently used nowadays as brimonidine. So it is used in open angle glaucoma and ocular hypertension as an adjunctive therapy with beta blocker in patient who cannot tell beta blocker due to the pulmonary or cardiovascular disease. So beta blocker is a drug of choice mostly in the developing country, as it is a cheaper drug and it is available everywhere. But in those patients who are the beta blocker is contraindicated, then in those patients we use this brimonidine, and it has got also other side effects like lid crusting, burning sensation, blurring of the vision, eyelid sensation. So it causes the irritations, eyelid edema, ocular hyperemia. So it has got a lot of hypersensitivity reaction. So all the patients cannot tolerate this drug alone. So that is why this drug is less frequently used than other drugs. Headache, oral dryness, abnormal test, depressions, hypertension, anxiety, palpitation, and syncope. Beta adrenergic blocker, these are presently the most frequently used anti-glaucoma drugs, and commonly used preparations are timolol and betaxolol. So other available preparations include the levobindanol, cartinolol, and metipranolol. So mechanism of action is the timolol and levobindanol are non-selective beta 1 cardiac and beta 2 smooth muscle receptor blocking agent. So this is a frequently asked questions to you, that where does beta 1 acts and where does beta 2 acts, and if you will say it acts on this smooth muscle, where are these muscle available? These are the questions which you can be asked. So betaxolol has 10 times more affinity than beta 1 than beta 2 receptor. So the drugs timolol and levobindanol lowers the IOP by blocking the beta 2 receptors in the ciliary process. So where these receptors are situated, resulting in the decreased aqueous production. The exact mechanism of actions of the cardioselective betaxolol is unknown. So this reduces the beta 2, it reduces the intraocular pressure by about 30 to 35% of the intraocular pressure. It decreases the aqueous production. So it is used in almost all type of glaucoma except to few contraindications. Developmental glaucoma, primary and secondary narrow angle glaucoma, ocular hypertension, and childhood glaucoma. And contraindications are bronchial asthma, emphysema, COPD, heart block, and congestive heart failure or cardiomyopathy. So you will be asked, what are the indications of the beta blocker? What are the contraindications of the beta blocker? So ocular hypertension. Ocular side effects are ocular irritations, conjunctival hyperemia, blepharitis, superficial punctate keratitis. So long-term use with the beta blocker, is the problem is that the patient can have the corneal problem. They can have the foreign body sensation. So because this is as in the previous slide, we have discussed about the ocular surface disease. So it's reflects due to this and also due to the preservatives which is used in the drugs. So always we try to use along with this the preservative free tear substitute, because we cannot use the we cannot stop the anti-glaucoma medications, and always the anti-glaucoma medication is with, till now is with the preservative. So we cannot do that. So always we try to use the preservative-free tear substitute to overcome this side effect. And patient can have diplopia due to this corneal problem and corneal anesthesia, hypersensitivity reaction, and visual disturbance, including refractive changes and behavior changes. Other side effects, systemic side effect like bradycardia, arrhythmia, hypotension, syncope, heart block, bronchospasm, CNS depression, cerebral ischemia, palpitation, and congestive heart failure. Because some of the examiner are very keen to ask you that what are the systemic side effects, because though it's in ophthal, you will think in ophthal exam why they are asking systemic side effect, but the most of the old examiner or examiner from the IOM, or they might think that we ophthalmologists only knows ophthalmology, or what we should ask systemic side effect also. So you should know this also. Carbonic anhydrase inhibitors are mechanism of action. It reduces the IOP by decreasing the aqueous humor formation by direct antagonist actions on the ciliary epithelium carbonic anhydrase. So it acts on the carbonic anhydrase enzymes. So as the name indicates, carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, it inhibits the enzyme carbonic anhydrase, so which is related to the process of aqueous humor production. Thus, carbonic anhydrase inhibitors lowers the IOP by reducing the aqueous humor formation. So over here, the anions are not get together hydrogen bicarbonate so that the water is not formed over here. So the aqueous is not formed over here. So this inhibitor will inhibit the enzyme. So it will not lead to form. As a monotherapy drugs or adjunctive treatment of chronic open-angle glaucoma, it is used. Secondary glaucoma preoperatively in intraoperative or in intraoperative surgery as a short-term management of all type of glaucoma. It is mostly used in all type of glaucoma as a short-term management. It is not used in the long-term management, but as a short-term management it is used. And it is either used in single drugs or in combination with the other drugs. But it has got lot of contraindications like hypersensitivity reaction. It has a cross sensitivity between the antibacterial sulfonamide group of drug or sulfonamide derivatives diuretics. So it is difficult, and we have to ask the history before starting the drugs. And respiratory disease, chronic respiratory disease, or liver and kidney disease and adrenocortical insufficiency. So 50% of the patients are unable to tolerate this carbonic anhydrase inhibitor for the long term, and they have the paresthesia, urinary frequency, and serum electrolyte imbalance. So these three problems, side effects, must explain to the patient before giving the drugs. It is very, very important. It is due to the bicarbonate depletions leading to the metabolic acidosis, and symptoms like malaise, fatigue, depression, loss of libido, anorexia, and weight loss. These are the problems with the electrolyte imbalance. Other gastrointestinal symptoms complex, it is caused by the biochemical changes in the serum. It includes the vague abdominal discomfort, gastric irritations, nausea, peculiar metabolic test, and diarrhea, and sulfonamide-related side effect of this carbonic anhydrase inhibitors is rarely the renal calculi formation, blood dyskinesis, Stevens-Johnson syndrome, transient myopia, hypertensive nephropathy, and teratogenic effects. So there are other topical carbonic anhydrase inhibitors also. So dorzolamide, which is frequently this drug is used, and dorzolamide hydrochloride is a carbonic anhydrase inhibitors which selectively inhibits the human carbonic anhydrase isoenzyme 2 and predominant isoenzyme found within the ciliary muscles process. So commercially, it is available at 2% solution, and it is applicable 8 hourly. It decreases the IOP by 18 to 22% by decreasing the aqueous humor production, and it is used as monotherapy or in the adjuvant with other anti-glaucoma agents like beta adrenergic antagonist. So it is well tolerated drugs with few side effects like transient blurring or stinging conjunctiva, blurring of vision, and some patient may show the punctate corneal epithelial erosion. So it actively appears to be slightly less in dark color iris as compared to the light color ones, and it has both the sulfonamide and second amine groups. So this dorzolamide, it is used topically. So other is the prostaglandin analogs, which is also important drugs, and it is the drug of choice in the developed country. So latanoprost is isopropyl esters of prostaglandin F2 alpha with the molecular weight of this. And it is available in 0.005% solutions of topical ocular administration. It has a low, it is a long acting drug, so it is used only once in 24 hours. On administration, the drug is hydrolyzed to latanoprost acids in cornea and passes in this form in the intraocular compartment. So it lowers the IOP by about 25 to 30% and chiefly by enhancing the EBO scleral outflow. So this is a well tolerated by the patient in mean untowards effect in darkening the iris color after 3 or 12 months of continuous use. This is a main side effect or disadvantages of these drugs, and we should explain this before giving the drugs, otherwise some patient may scold you also why you have given like this type of drugs. The other side effect that has been reported include the conjunctival hyperemia and upper respiratory tract infections also. These drugs can be used in monotherapy or in combinations with the beta adrenergic agonists like timolol maleate. So it is a very good drug. So latanoprost, I have discussed, it is used in open angle glaucoma and ocular hypertension. Is also we can use this drugs to the patient who has not developed the glaucoma. So it has got the hypersensitivity to the drugs and inflammation to the eye. It can cause iritis, uveitis. So this drug is not used in uveit cases or in the ocular inflammatory disease. So it is used once daily. So it is easy to use also. So these are the lots of side effect of these drugs, but these are very minimum. Long-term use, it can cause cystoid macular edema as an ocular side effect and keratitis, and it causes lots of burning vision. So we always advise this patient to use the drug just before the sleep. And other systemic side effect like cold and flu-like syndrome, pain in the muscle, joint and back, and chest pain, rashes, and allergic reaction. So I think we will stop over here with the latanoprost, and we will continue in the next class with the hyperosmotic agents and other drugs and laser and surgery in the next class. So you have to go revise in the next class. We will again discuss about this. And this is also hypertrichosis is also a problem with the latanoprost. So this is a very important